Hello friends, how are you all? My name is Arshad Dwivedi and I welcome you back to my video. So in this video friends, I will be talking to you regarding eutrophication and algal blooms. And before coming on to eutrophication and algal blooms, we need to understand what is water pollution. Okay, and I will be analyzing the causes of the water pollution. These causes may be sewage water, industrial water, agricultural pollution, thermal pollution, then nuclear pollution, then marine pollution, invasive species, then pollution in the underground water. All of these types of pollutions I will be discussing with you. Then I will be telling you that what is the precise impact of this water pollution on human life, animal life, aquatic life, environment. Then finally we will move on to eutrophication, because when we talk about water pollution, the very important thing becomes eutrophication, and the next level of eutrophication is algal blooms. So all of these things will be discussed by me in this video friends. So this video is presented by me, Harshit Dwivedi. If you want to follow me, the link of my Instagram profile is given in the description box below. This video is in English. If you want to watch the Hindi version of the video, the link of that is also given below. So without wasting time, let's move on with it. Actually, it's quite a big video, so obviously the duration of the video will be a bit long. I'm not sure how much it will be, but yes, it will be long. So what is basically pollution friends? Pollution happens when something undesirable enters an ecosystem. For example, if we are talking about water here, so water in its natural course, if it is clean, suppose, and if in clean water we are going to add some undesirable substances, so when we are going to add some undesirable substances in it, it will become polluted, and that will become water pollution. Now these undesirable substances can be varied. These can be biological, they can be nuclear, radiological, they can be chemical, they can be industrial waste, they can be organic waste, they can be inorganic waste. The difference between organic and inorganic I have talked numerous times in my previous environment videos. If you are listening to them, it will be very much clear to you. Then there is one thing as thermal pollution. What happens in the thermal pollution? In thermal pollution, the temperature of the water rises. And when the temperature of water rises, obviously the conditions for aquatic organisms living inside that water, they become adverse. They start dying, because as the water temperature will rise, the level of dissolved oxygen will decrease. I will come on to dissolved oxygen in a minute's time. Okay, now there are varied sources of pollution of water. If we talk about the natural sources of pollution of water, the very first comes on as soil erosion. Soil erosion is going on. Various agents of denudation are under play. These agents are denudation are wind, water, glaciers, snow, anything, everything like that. So basically these agents of denudation are performing soil erosion. That is, soil from the terrestrial ecosystem is making its way into canals, waterways, estuaries and river bodies, lakes, blah blah blah. So this is soil erosion. So this is basically a natural source of pollution, but because of human activities, the rate of soil erosion has aggravated a lot. How it is aggravated? You very well know friends, nowadays deforestation is going on. Now forests are famous for binding soil. If forestation is there in an area, the roots of the trees of those forests will bind the soil and it will not flow it easily. Okay. When we are going to cut these very trees, obviously the soil will be let loose, because then there will be no tree roots to bind them. And in that case, the soil erosion will intensify, it will get aggravated. Then leaching of minerals from rocks. Now what is this leaching of minerals from rocks? See, when we talk about rocks, I have already made a video on rocks. I have already told you the classification of rocks. All of these things with respect to rocks, I have already completed. Kindly refer to my geography and environmental playlist. There you will find everything with respect to rocks. Separate videos have been made. Now friends, these rocks contain many metallic minerals. They also contain many non-metallic minerals. Okay. Now what is happening friends, that if the minerals get detached from these rocks, now how they will get detached from the rocks? Some minerals are naturally soluble, so they water will flow over them and it will get detached from the rocks. Many a times acid rain is a big reason for detaching the minerals from the rocks. Now what is acid rain? I already told you the phenomenon of acid rains. You know that sulfur oxides are there in the air. This is because of the pollution. Okay, the majority of the sulfur dioxide, around 90% of the sulfur dioxide in air, is because of human reasons and not naturally. Okay, so in that case, you know, when sulfur oxides are there in the air and when these sulfur dioxides react with water, they are going to form sulfuric acid, H2SO4. Okay, this sulfuric acid, when the precipitation is going to occur, this sulfuric acid with the precipitation will come down to ground as H2SO4. Now, when this H2SO4 will come down, this H2SO4 is what? It is acid, friends, and that will become an acid rain. And the occurrences of acid rain has been increasing recently a lot. Okay, so because of this acid rain, the leaching of minerals from the rocks is happening. The minerals are getting detached from the rocks. So all of these things are happening. Then if we talk about the sources of pollution, friends, there are normally two sources of pollution. There are a lot of, you can say, differentiation criteria. This is one sort of differentiation called point source of solution and non-point source of solution. Now, what is happening in the point source of pollution? Point source of pollution, you are very well aware that from which source the pollution is happening. For example, friends, suppose in an area there are two or three very big industries, and those two or three very big industries have laid down a big network of drainage pipes, and that drainage pipes is emitting effluent of those industries. So basically those drainage pipes are going to have an outlet, and that outlet will become the point source of the pollution. So this is point source of pollution. That means we are very well aware of that particular location from which the pollution is happening. Then second is a non-point source of pollution. In this non-point source of pollution, these are very much variable. We will not be able to decide a particular place from which that particular pollution is happening. For example, construction is going on at a site. The pollution is coming from that site. When the construction will be over, some other place construction will be going on. From there, the pollution will come. So there is no one place. Then in a mining is going on. Okay. So, one mine is mined, it gets completed, the whole coal has come out, then the mine will go to some other place. So obviously the source of pollution, the location of the pollution is changing, again changing. In agricultural field it is also happening, pits it is also happening. So these are basically non-point sources of pollution, where we will not be exactly able to decipher from where the pollution is coming. So treating and managing point source of pollution is comparatively easy. Why? Because we know the exact source from where the pollution is coming. And non-point source of pollution, it is highly variable. We don't know the exact location from where the pollution is coming. So obviously controlling it will become a little bit tricky. Then friends, we are going to talk about sewage water. What is this sewage water? See, in houses, you are consuming water. You are consuming water for drinking, for making food. Okay. Then you are consuming water for bathing and other activities. So when you are consuming this water, and when you have already consumed this water will go in sewage and it will become sewage water. Similar thing is happening in industries. I'm sorry, friends. In industries also, obviously those industries and big establishment, they are using water. Okay, and after using water, they are going to discharge that water. So in that case, that water will also become sewage water. So sewage water will obviously contain human excreta, human waste, animal waste. It will contain food residue. Obviously, the food that will discharge, that will be in it. Then it will be having detergents used for washing clothes. Okay. The most dangerous type of sewage is the hospital sewage. In hospital sewage, what is happening, friends, that, you know, in hospitals, a lot of cotton is used, syringes are used. So these are contaminated with a lot of diseases. So when these are discharged, they should be treated properly, because if the hospital sewage is not treated properly, it can lead to, you can say, diffusion of diseases in a lot of places. Now, what is the concept of dissolved oxygen? Dissolved oxygen is, you can say, is the amount of water, so amount of oxygen that is dissolved in a particular amount of water. Now, if you have to, know the level of pollution in a water according to the levels of dissolved oxygen, if any water is having less than 8 mg per liter of dissolved oxygen, then in that case it will be known as contaminated. So if water is having less than 8 mg per liter of dissolved oxygen, it will become contaminated. If the water is having less than 4 mg per liter of oxygen, then it will become what? It will become highly polluted. We will come on to why, according to the level of oxygen, we are assessing the pollution of the water. This I am going to come. The reason for this is that the amount of organic, if the amount of organic and inorganic waste in the water is going on increasing, that will ultimately lead to the reduction of dissolved oxygen content in the water. So the more the level of organic and inorganic waste in the water, the less will be the level of dissolved oxygen. Now this dissolved oxygen content of water is very important for the survival of aquatic organisms, because these aquatic organisms are depending upon this dissolved oxygen for their survival. Okay, there are a whole lot of other things. Now what is happening, that the more the amount of waste is going inside the water, obviously that waste has to be decomposed. Bacteria will be decomposing this waste. So more the amount of this waste, bacteria will be involved in its decomposition. So the work of bacteria will increase, the energy consumed by the bacteria will increase, and the oxygen consumed by this bacteria will also increase. So that will reduce the amount of dissolved oxygen in that water. And the lesser the amount of dissolved oxygen in water, we can very well assume the more is the amount of waste, that is organic waste and inorganic waste in the water. So you got it? That why, if the dissolved oxygen level is less, the pollution is more? Because dissolved oxygen is less, because bacteria is consuming that dissolved oxygen to decompose this organic and inorganic waste. Now two things I am going to talk about here, friends. One is biological oxygen demand. Oxygen demand. Second is chemical oxygen demand. Now what is this biological oxygen demand and what is this chemical oxygen demand? See, when we talk about water pollution by organic waste, just keep in mind, organic waste, that is biodegradable. Okay, so when we talk about organic waste that is biodegradable, we will talk about biological oxygen demand. And when we talk about, you can say, organic waste that is biodegradable and non-biodegradable, that is organic waste which is biodegradable and non-biodegradable, plus oxidizable inorganic compounds. So biological oxygen demand is catering only to organic waste that is biodegradable, and chemical oxygen demand is catering to organic waste which is both biodegradable and non-biodegradable, plus oxidizable inorganic compounds. Okay, so basically what is happening in biological oxygen demand, the more the amount of organic waste which is biodegradable, the more will be the activity of the bacteria and the more will be the amount of oxygen consumed. But this is not a good, you can say, this is not a good parameter of measuring this thing, because only organic waste which is biodegradable is considered here. When we talk about chemical oxygen demand, organic waste which is biodegradable and non-biodegradable both are, you can say, considered, and oxidizable inorganic compounds. So all of these things are considered here. So obviously this chemical oxygen demand will be a better parameter of measuring water pollution, because here organic waste, both biodegradable and non-biodegradable, are considered, and oxidizable inorganic compounds are also considered. Whereas in biological oxygen demand, only the organic waste which are biodegradable are considered. So basically what is happening in both the things, the amount of dissolved oxygen that will be consumed by the bacteria for decomposing this waste, that will be the biological oxygen demand and chemical oxygen demand. Again, I'm repeating, the amount of dissolved oxygen consumed by the bacteria to decompose the waste present in the water will be termed as biological oxygen demand, chemical oxygen demand. Biological oxygen demand, the waste will be organic waste which is biodegradable. Chemical oxygen demand, the waste will be organic waste which is biodegradable and non-biodegradable, plus oxidizable inorganic compounds. Now, when we talk about industrial waste, friends, so a lot of industrial waste are coming from petroleum industry, paper industries, metal extraction, so chemical manufacturing. So these are mercury, cadmium, copper, lead, arsenic. So we are talking about mercury, lead, cadmium, copper, arsenic. Okay. So what are these? I will be discussing with you one by one. Okay. Also, there are some agricultural sources of pollution. Okay, in agricultural sources of pollution will come nitrates, phosphates, ammonia. So these are the, ammonia is there. Then this nitrogen and phosphorus will also be included in it. Okay, now what is happening here, friends? You know that in agriculture, you apply fertilizers, or obviously those fertilizers will comprise of nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. Okay. Now, when in India, you very well know that excess amounts of fertilizers are applied. Now, those excess amounts of fertilizer cannot be utilized. So what will happening when rain will fall on the soil, how the underground water is found? What is happening, friends, that when the rain is falling down? Okay. So that is slowly leaching in from the soil and going into underground pits, and there is depositing as underground water. So from millions of years, this underground water has been deposited. What will happen that when the soil is having higher levels of nutrients like nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium, with the leaching water, these nutrients will also leach and they will go into underground water, and then they will cause underground water pollution. So this nitrogen, phosphorus, basically these phosphates, they trace quantities of them are also found in underground water, and underground water pollution is also becoming a big problem nowadays for mankind. Okay, then in agriculture, friends, we are using a lot of pesticides, insecticides, herbicides, So basically, these are the chemicals that we are deploying, and obviously these are a wide range of chemicals. They are also known as chlorinated hydrocarbons. They are also known as organochlorine. I've already made a video on organochlorine pollution and Stockholm Convention. So I will request you to go and watch this video. So examples of them are DDT, endosulfan. DDT and endosulfan, both, they are a part of 26 chemicals that are banned under this Stockholm Convention. Initially, there were 12. DDT was that in 12. Endosulfan was included after some time. So basically, this DDT, endosulfan, their use is banned under the Stockholm Convention, heavily regulated. I've already made a video on it. Kindly go and watch it. Okay, so this is also one sort of pollution. Then the next pollution which we are going to talk about is the thermal pollution. Now, what is basically this thermal pollution, friends? What is happening that, these power plants, this live example I will give you, friends, the Badarpur thermal power plant in Badarpur, New Delhi, it is a 705 megawatt power plant. Now, in this 705 megawatt power plant, what is happening? That obviously the coal is burned, the water is converted into steam, that is, steam is running, the plant, and obviously the electricity is produced, and after the steam is utilized, it is again converted into water. That water is hot water. Okay. Now, in Badarpur power plant, there is two units, cooling units, which are cooling those hot water, and after that hot water is released to the canal from which it was taken. Now, this canal, friends, we watch that canal from this water, which from which the water was taken by the plant, and friends, from into which the water was released. I have watched that canal. When the water from Badarpur thermal power station was released in this canal, despite of cooling it, it was so hot that obviously it increased the temperature of the canal by, say, 10 to 20 degrees centigrade or 15 to 20 degrees centigrade. So what is happening, this power pollution, what is happening in this, that, friends, the power plants which are utilizing this water, they are releasing hot water in the canal, and that hot water is increasing the temperature of the canal by, say, 15 to 20 degrees Celsius. Now, the aquatic organisms which are living inside that canal, they can actually withstand a temperature increase of, say, 1 degree to 3 or 4 degrees, but they cannot withstand a temperature increase of 15 to 20 degrees centigrade. So obviously they are going to die because of it. Okay. Also, when the thermal pollution will happen, the more the temperature of the water, the lesser will be the level of dissolved oxygen. Just keep in mind, the more the temperature of the water, the lesser will be the level of dissolved oxygen in it. Okay, so this is one more problem with thermal pollution, friends. Okay, also, this thermal pollution is becoming a big problem. As I've already told you, the decreased dissolved oxygen is there. Dissolved oxygen level is decreasing. So obviously, this is going to heavily affect the water aquatic ecosystem. The organisms are going to die, the planktons are going to die. If the planktons will die, small fish will die and other aquatic plants will die. This water will become dormant, stagnant. Okay, then the next thing which we are going to talk about, nuclear pollution or radiation pollution. Radiation pollution, see friends, in nuclear power plants, if you talk about nuclear power plants, in nuclear power plants, water is also used. Okay, now this water, it is shielded from the radiation of this nuclear energy. Okay, obviously the in this, you can say in the main boiler of this nuclear power plant, it is heavily shielded from outside. If for any reason there is a rupture in this shield, obviously the nuclear radiation is going to go outside and that will affect the water also and other people also who are in the vicinity. Similar thing happened in Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster in Japan. Fukushima Daiichi nuclear disaster in Japan, which was actually a very unfortunate event. So basically this nuclear accidents is also one thing which has a big impact. And also when the aquatic organisms and obviously the terrestrial organisms, they are exposed to these nuclear radiation, their DNA changes, a lot of genetic changes happens in those organisms which will go on for generations. So it affects the organisms for generations and not for one generation. Okay, so that's why it's very dangerous, you would say. Then there are these pollutions like marine pollution is there, friends. You know, the sewerage and garbage of the coastal cities is discharged in the ocean. People think that we are going to discharge all of these things in the ocean and the ocean is going to take all of these things in it as if it is a reservoir. But no, that pollution is also affecting the ocean, friends. Okay, then we talk about oil spills. What is oil spill, friend? Many times you hear that a big tanker, you know, it got ruptured in the ocean. Now, when a huge amount of oil is ruptured in the ocean, suppose this is the ocean. Now, this oil is lighter than the water. So, this oil is going to float on the surface of the water. Okay. So, this oil will increase the turbidity of the water. That is why the sunlight will not be able to penetrate the water. Then, oxygen will not be able to penetrate the water. In that case, what will happen? The organisms which are in the water, they are going to die. Because oil has formed the upper layer of the water due to this oil spill, and that is why no sunlight and no oxygen is going beneath now. That is why aquatic organisms will start dying. Okay, and it will become a, you can say, a dead zone in that case, because oil spill becomes very dangerous many a times. You know, this phytoplanktons, they will die of suffocation. Obviously, then shellfish will die, fishes will die, and slowly, slowly, large fishes will also start dying. So oil spill is also very dangerous. Then we talk about invasive species, friends. There is one invasive species, that is water hyacinth. H-Y-A-C-I-N-T-H. So this water hyacinth is a very problematic aquatic weed. It aggravates the process of eutrophic water bodies. Okay, it is also known as terror of Bengal. Okay, it heavily pollutes the water. Plankton start dying, fishes start dying. Lot of things like this is happening. Then underground water pollution, I've already talked to you about the underground water pollution. A lot of underground water pollution is happening nowadays. You are going to find fluorides, uranium, heavy metal. So all of these things are formed, you know, nitrates, phosphorus. So these are formed, even uranium in trace quantities. So these are found in underground waters. So you can very well understand the magnitude of the problem here. The underground water is containing these elements also. Now, what is the problem associated with this? If we talk about nitrates, friends, nitrates, the excess of nitrates will cause a disease known as blue baby syndrome. Now, what is happening in blue baby syndrome, friends? You know, you have heard about an element named hemoglobin in the human body. In the blood, our hemoglobin is there. Okay. Now, this hemoglobin work is that it transports oxygen throughout the body. Now, if nitrate pollution increases and if nitrate makes its way into the human bodies, it is going to react with hemoglobin and find and form methemoglobinemia. And this methemoglobin is going to impair oxygen transport inside our body. This is going to cause blue baby syndrome. Okay. Then we talk about arsenic. So basically arsenic is a big component in the fly ash of power plants. It is also present in mine discharges, industrial discharges. It causes the black foot disease. So arsenic causes black foot disease. It also causes skin and lung cancer. Okay, then we talk about fluoride pollution. Now, fluoride in trace quantities is very important for our bones. It is very important for our teeth and overall body functioning. But if excess fluoride reaches into our body, okay, if excess fluoride reaches, it will do deformity in bones. It will do deformity in teeth. Okay, it will cause knock knee syndrome. Just read about knock knee syndrome. It can cause many, you can say, neurological problems, neuromuscular problems can be there, gastrointestinal problems can be there, painful joints will be there, hardening of bones will be there. Many times the bone will, you know, the bones of yours will, you can say, curve outwards. So problems like these will happen due to the excess of fluorine. So you can see that the effect of water pollution on human health is quite big. Okay, it's quite big and it needs to be contained. For example, if mercury poisoning happened, so in mercury, there is a Minamata convention, if you have heard about it. So Minamata is basically a disease. It is a neurological syndrome that happens in humans if humans consume mercury, because mercury contains the extremely toxic methyl mercury, and when this methyl mercury goes inside the human body, it will cause numbness of limbs, lip. It will cause deafness, it will cause your vision to be blurred, it can also make you mad, it can lead to mental derangement. So all of these things are happening due to the intake of mercury. Okay, so mercury is also very dangerous. Then lead poisoning is also dangerous. Then cadmium is also dangerous. Cadmium pollution is also there, and this cadmium leads to a disease known as ouch disease. Ouch disease. This ouch disease is also known as itai. So itai disease is also there. It is basically a painful disease of bones and joints. It can also cause the cancer of lungs and livers. So you are able to see, friends, that how big this problem can become many a times. How to solve it? That's a big thing. First of all, we are going to talk about eutrophication, and then we are going to talk about algal blooms. Now, what is eutrophication? You very well know, friends, that the lakes and the waterways, they are receiving from surface runoff. They are receiving water for surface runoff. Now, that water is containing many chemical substances. That water is containing many minerals. Now, eutrophication is not a fast process. Eutrophication takes millions and thousands of years to happen. So slowly these nutrients are getting accumulated inside water. This organic matter are getting accumulated inside water, and the water is enriching in nutrients. So a lot of nutrients are now present in the water. So for example, we talk about a lake. So if lake is there, now slowly a lot of nutrients are there inside the lake. Now obviously, when the nutrient enrichment of the lake is high, obviously the planktons will grow at a very high rate, and these will be the weedy planktons, not the good planktons. So there are two types of eutrophication. One is natural eutrophication and other is cultural eutrophication. When this eutrophication, when this nutrient enrichment is happening due to natural reasons, when this eutrophication is happening completely due to natural reasons, then it will become natural eutrophication. But what is happening, that human activities nowadays is aggravating things. So when this nutrient enrichment of water is happening due to human activities at an aggravated pace, then it will become cultural eutrophication. So the same thing is happening in eutrophication, that is the nutrient enrichment of the water is happening. So nutrient enrichment of the water is happening, but if it is happening in a natural manner, that will become natural eutrophication. If it is happening due to human activities, it will become cultural eutrophication. And the same thing will happen, that the amount of nutrients will increase, planktons will increase, that planktons are going to consume more oxygen, so dissolved oxygen will decrease. And if the dissolved oxygen will decrease, small fishes are going to die, then the bigger fishes are going to die, and it is going to affect the organisms which are in the higher trophic level. Now, if we talk about lakes, we can categorize the lakes of India or the lakes of world into three types. Oligotrophic is the first type. The second type is mesotrophic. The third type is eutrophic. In oligotrophic, the nutrient content is very low. In mesotrophic, the nutrient content is medium. In eutrophic, the nutrient content is very high. Okay, friends, so oligotrophic low, mesotrophic moderate, eutrophic high. Okay, friends. So basically in India, most of the lakes are either eutrophic or mesotrophic because the nutrient derived from the surrounding and the organic waste and inorganic waste entering the water are pretty huge. So this is eutrophication. What is happening in algal bloom? Algal bloom is one step ahead of eutrophication. What is happening that when the eutrophication is going to increase up to a very high level, the plankton population will increase so much that it is going to occupy the upper layer of the water. So this plankton population is increasing so much that it is going to occupy the upper layer of the water. And when it is going to occupy the upper layer of the water, it will cause turbidity. So this phytoplankton, that is blue-green bacteria, it has so much population that now it is covering the entire surface layer. And this covering of the entire surface layer will become algal bloom. Okay, friends. Now, we're going to talk about them also. This phytoplankton, they also produce, you know, oxygen through photosynthesis. But during nights, friends, they consume very high oxygen. So this much huge amount of phytoplankton reduces the dissolved oxygen at a very aggravated pace during the night. Okay. So obviously, small fishes are going to die as more and more oxygen is taken up by them. Now, when these type of conditions will arise, there arises a bacteria. There is a growth of bacteria whose name is Clostridium botulinum. Clostridium botulinum. So this Clostridium botulinum, they also produce toxins which are deadly to aquatic organisms, birds and mammals. So this is what is basically happening. And you know, when the water is warm, friends, so this water, a warm water is more conducive to algal blooms, friends. Now, this algal blooms, they are also known as red tide because normally their color is either red or brown. So, if their color is red, they will become red tide. If their color is brown, they will become brown tide. Okay, friends. So, this effects of eutrophication is quite high because the eutrophication increases the turbidity, the coral reefs will die. New species invasion is there. Then what will happen, friends, that if eutrophication is happening, obviously the freshwater lakes will start converting themselves into terrestrial ecosystem because this freshwater ecosystem will not be able to maintain itself. So when it will not be able to maintain itself, it is going to convert itself into a terrestrial ecosystem because it is slowly, slowly, slowly degrading. Death of aquatic plant is happening. So all of these things will slowly, 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 slowly go on happening, friends. Then these harmful algal blooms, they are also going to produce a lot of toxins. They are going to produce toxicity in the aquatic environment that is very dangerous for the whole system. So slowly, slowly, it is going to convert itself into terrestrial ecosystem. One thing, few methods we need to discover through which we can mitigate eutrophication. So one thing is that the wastewater which is being emitted by the industries and households, they should be treated. So sewage treatment plant should be brought in. So, see, sewage treatment plant will reduce the level of nutrients in the water. So, nutrient enhancement will be reduced. So, obviously, eutrophication will be minimized. Okay. Then, riparian buffers should be established. Now, what is this riparian buffer? What is happening there? For example, fresh water is flowing. Okay. Wastewater is coming. So, a buffer should be there in between. This buffer can be wetlands. This buffer can be lands. This buffer can be anything. So, this buffer is going to consume a lot of pollutants and the wastewater that is going inside the main freshwater body that is not going to contain nutrients in that quantity and eutrophication will be slowed down. Then, friends, fertilizers should be used in a more efficient and effective manner. It should not be used indiscriminately the manner in which it is used right now. For example, the neem-coated urea concept of India is quite a good thing because limited amount of oxygen is released and that is not dangerous for the ecosystem. Then nitrogen testing should be there. What is nitrogen testing? That every area should be tested that how much amount of fertilizer, how much amount of nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium it requires. And accordingly, the fertilizer should be made and applied. Organic farming should be, you can say, promoted. Organic farming is promoted. Obviously, this organic farming is very much conducive to our environment. Nitrogen emissions from power plant should be minimized, from vehicles should be minimized. So, all of these things should be done, friends. Okay. So, when combinedly these all processes will be done, water pollution can be minimized. The different levels of water pollution, you know, it needs a consolidated planning because it is quite a big thing. It is not a small thing. Controlling eutrophication and algal blooms is quite a difficult task nowadays and a whole lot of effort is required from the government, from the NGOs, and even from the people, because people are the biggest pollution creators. So they need to have a control on their activities, then only this pollution can be controlled. So this was a complete detail about this video. I hope this video was helpful for you. If it was really helpful, friends, kindly subscribe to my channel. Kindly tell me through your comments that how you like this video. Kindly like this video and please share it on your Instagram and Facebook profile. That will help me get some views. So thank you for watching this video, friends. Have a great day. Goodbye. Keep studying hard.